of Champions is going to eat your old fighting games for lunch.
16 bits. 16 bits!
An evil empire is sucking the life force from the planet. It's up to one soldier of fortune to save the world.
Man, stay off the light speed!
My bad.
Sonic Adventure on Sega Dreamcast.
Throughout the 1990s, technology was rapidly accelerating and pushing new boundaries.
What do you get when you combine the killer be killed perspective of Doom with about a dozen futuristic tanks?
We went from Nintendo Super Famicom, released in November of 1990, closing out the decade with a Sega Dreamcast, releasing in November of 1998. 8 years separated two entire generations of gaming. In the middle of that time span is where we find our story today, with the initial launch of Sega's first optical media platform, the Mega CD.
Touch me. Mega CD.
I'd originally planned to do a deep dive video for the 30th anniversary of the Sega CD launch in the United States, but I figured that'd be somewhat of an American exceptionalist point of view to take. So after much consideration, I decided to go ahead and do a video on the actual launch of the platform. Before we can even get started waxing poetic about these shiny discs packed with binary data, we have to first consider the landscape of the gaming industry at the time, predominantly relying on the coin-op and casino gaming business throughout the mid-20th century. Sega began researching the prospect of dabbling in the home console market as a result of arcade traffic dramatically dwindling in the early 80s. July 15, 1983 saw the release of both the Sega SG-1000 as well as the Nintendo Famicom in Japan, and the third generation of gaming was officially underway. As 1984 came to a close, thanks mostly to its more advanced technology and broader library of titles, the Famicom was easily outpacing sales of the SG-1000. So Sega figured the best way to combat that was a mid-generation refresh, similar to the 3DS leading to the new 3DS. In comes the SG-1000 Mark III, or Master System for the rest of the world.
Game leader! Sega!
Released in October of 1985, and boasting much more advanced hardware than the competition. For a short time, the Master System was the most powerful home console on the market. However, since technology never stops, that was just a short season. As the third generation of game consoles was well at its zenith, the next evolution came in October of 1987 with the release of the NEC PC Engine, the world's first 16-bit home console. This classification was being carried by the video encoders rather than the actual CPU itself, which remained an 8-bit chip. The PC Engine entered the market to be the first legitimate successor to the stranglehold dominance Nintendo had levied for the past 4 years, and with that ushered in the next generation in video game hardware, the fourth generation. The PC Engine in Japan was an immediate success, boasting 500,000 units in sales in its first week on the market alone. It was clear that this is no longer a business experiment, but home console gaming was now an established industry. Not resting on their laurels, Sega was already deep into the development of their fourth generation offering as well. Having a successful arcade division meant that they were already able to develop new technologies and then work on paring them down for home conversions later. 1985 saw the successor of their hugely popular System 1 and 2 boards, the System 16 board, utilized to deliver the fast pace of vibrant action of Fantasy Zone, Alex Kidd the Lost Stars, and Shinobi. Based around a Motorola 68000 chip, Sega began developing a home unit that would take advantage of most of the same hardware as the arcade unit, allowing for easier home conversions. October 29, 1988 saw the release of the Sega Mega Drive in Japan, with only two launch titles, Space Harrier 2 and Super Thunderblade. Both showed off the power and speed of the new 16-bit processor and began to solidify Sega as a powerful competitor in the home gaming industry. In a stroke of genius, Sega had included an expansion card port on every Mega Drive unit manufactured. In 1988, this seemed mostly overlooked, but a few years later, Sega would find great use for this.
Family computer ni excite bike tojo.
As the fourth generation was picking up steam, Nintendo was initially fine with continuing their success at the Famicom, but soon after they began to lose market share to NEC and Sega, their outlook started to change. Having the advantage of holding back, they were able to study the competition and make some responses to the existing hardware and excel in areas where Sega came up short. Going on sale in Japan in November of 1990, the Nintendo Super Famicom was an instant smash hit. Selling out the entire shipped inventory within hours. Equipped with a graphics chip that could display double the amount of sprites loaded on screen and more colors on screen, it was clear that Sega was now lagging behind when it came to specs on paper. Lines would be drawn into Santa playgrounds around the globe, and we were all soldiers in a new age battle. There would be no room for compromise in the great console war of the early 90s. While Sega and Nintendo were investing in an arms race of cartridge-based software, December of 1988 saw NEC leapfrog the entire industry and release the first optical media-based game platform with the PC Engine CD-ROM. This is a world first in gaming, as not even PC games were being released on CDs yet. That would come a year later in 1989 with The Manhole for Macintosh. Sega took notice of this and immediately started developing a unit that could compete. Revealed to the public at the Tokyo Toy Show in June of 1991, the Mega CD would be the next iteration in Sega's strategy for home consoles. This new peripheral was able to interface together to deliver new experiences through a bevy of new hardware components over compact discs. For the Super Famicom, Nintendo had 2 years to advance their hardware, so it was a no-brainer to add sprite scaling and rotation capabilities. In turn, Sega also made sure to have that in place as well, thanks in part to the Mega CD coming equipped with its own Motorola 68000 processor, this time clocked at nearly twice the speed of the Mega Drive at 12.5 MHz. Along with the CPU, the Mega CD was equipped with a custom Sega 315 graphics processor, which allowed for independent sprite scaling and rotation, which not many developers actually took advantage of, unfortunately. The NBA Jam port should have been much closer to the arcade, but Iguana cheaped out and just slapped Redbook Audio on the Genesis version and called it a day. Sonic CD, however, did utilize this feature to great lengths, which makes this release a must-own for the platform. In addition, the Mega CD was equipped with a Ricoh RF5C164 sound chip that allowed 8 channels of PCM audio. After hearing about the possibility of NEC upping their onboard RAM for the upcoming Super CD add-on, Sega decided on 4 megabits of system RAM in addition to 2 megabits of video RAM, boasting a total of 6 megabits of RAM for the Mega CD. The system also came with a CD-ROM data cache bank of 16 kilobytes, with all this RAM together allowing for preloading of levels, so the disk drive is then relegated to just playing crystal clear digital audio in real time. And all this brought together by a CD-ROM drive with a 1x speed access time, which to me seems a technical marvel, as just a year previous, Sega of America was literally putting out fires in their offices because pre-production units were exploding. Apparently, Sega of Japan, in all their infinite wisdom, were planning on utilizing music CD drives for the Mega CD, and they had not taken into consideration all the random seeking and access times a game would require.
NBA Jam Halftime Report! Altitude with an attitude!
I think this technology would have been more capable if they had just released FMV titles, considering the fact that FMV games were all played in real time off the disc, much like watching a Laserdisc or a DVD.
Do it. Damn, a kerosene heater. It's out of here.
A Unfortunately, the world would have to wait about another year for this showcase, as the first FMV title on the Mega CD wouldn't be released until Thunderstorm dropped in August of 1992. Unlike the stacked launch lineup the following year in North America, for the launch in Japan, the Mega CD was accompanied by only two titles, Heavy Nova and sol-feace. Neither of these titles really do much for me, so I can't say how they would have resonated with the general audience 30 years ago. However, Japanese gaming outlet Beat Magazine did review both titles in their January 92 issue and gave both selections an above average score. But as tradition dictates, we'll go ahead and take a cursory look at each release. Developed and published by Micronet comes Heavy Nova. For those of you who've seen my Sega CD from A to Z episode covering Black Hole Assault, Heavy Nova is basically where a majority of the inspiration for that game came from. Developed by practically the exact same team, with almost the exact same concept, comes this very clunky and clumsy fighter and platformer mashup. It's essentially a 2D fighter, but requires you to traverse a platformer mini level just to get to your opponent. I try not to go too deep into angry ranting when it comes to covering old games, so suffice to say, this game has very little redeeming quality to it. The controls are near unresponsive. The hitboxes are the size of an atom. The gameplay mechanic is so cumbersome in execution, it's dang near unplayable. I realize this is a brand new platform, and for most, a brand new medium altogether, but that should be no excuse for whatever the goal was for this title. The only redeeming factor I can come up with is the soundtrack is pretty decent. Composed and recorded by Naoko and Studio River Kings, there are some excellent tracks here. All of that to say, there's little reason to seek this out. But if you do, just considering that you're paying for the soundtrack, with a bonus game on top of that that will offer little to no play value in the first place. I can't even recommend renting this.
Take off!
Next in the list, like I've said close to an infinity number of times before, I'm not a fan of shooters or bullet hells or whatever the heck the genre is. I'm just trash at these games, so I usually don't spend much time on them outside of content for this channel. Developed and published by Wolf Team, the same guys who brought us Time Gal and Cobra Command, comes sol-feace. Seven stages of satanic level difficulty that I find it hard to believe even the developers themselves were able to complete. The game was so impossible that I was reduced to having to use cheat codes just to get past the first level and make any sort of progression for the recording. Difficulty aside, the level design is very well thought out with beautiful graphics. I did like how things flowed and how the progression worked through the level. Much like all these shooters, there are power-ups, and I felt like this game was very liberal with the power-ups, so that was nice. Since I was dying every 3 seconds, it was a welcome gesture to see a power-up immediately after respawning. The biggest thing I can praise is the amazing soundtrack. Composed by Matoi Sakuraba, the same man who brought us the banging soundtracks for Shining Force 3, as well as the main composer for the music in Granada and Road Avenger, the tracks in sol-feace cannot be slept on. All in all, this is a really good shooter for those who like the genre. Out of the two games available on launch day, this one would have been a no-brainer to own. So there you have it. December 12, 1991 was by no means a banner day for Sega's third-party software division, but at least it was a foundation or groundwork laid for better things to come. So I guess that about wraps it up for today's video. I hope you enjoyed it, and thanks for watching, and peace out.